Hello everyone, this is Anthony Chan. Welcome to my lecture series on essential medical liver pathology for trainees and general pathologists interested in liver pathology. We reviewed the normal histology of the liver and learned how to handle and process liver biopsy tissue in the first lecture. In this lecture, let's now explore the key pathological changes associated with liver injury. The liver displays a limited range of morphological changes in response to a diverse array of infectious, metabolic, immune-mediated, or vascular injuries. Many of these changes are neither pathognomonic nor specific, meaning they can be associated with a variety of different disorders. This non-specificity can make it challenging to diagnose the underlying cause of liver damage based solely on individual pathological changes. We have to systematically examine and interpret pathological changes in the liver and combine these changes into a distinct histological pattern. By correlating the histological pattern with clinical, biochemical, serological, and radiological information, an accurate and clinically relevant diagnosis, or at least a set of differential diagnoses, can usually be achieved. This comprehensive approach emphasizes that clinical pathological correlation is essential in evaluating medical liver diseases. Most pathological changes in liver injury can be categorized as cellular damage, inflammation, intracellular accumulation, regeneration, as well as fibrosis. Cellular damage and inflammation are grouped under necroinflammatory activity, also referred to as grade, whereas fibrosis indicates chronicity, also known as stage. Let's start with cellular damage. Hepatocytes and cholangiocytes are susceptible to various sublethal and lethal injuries in a broad spectrum of liver diseases. Identifying the distinct morphologies of cellular damage can offer diagnostic clues to the underlying etiology. Ballooning degeneration is characterized by cellular swelling of the hepatocyte, rarefaction of its cytoplasm, and the presence of clumped strands of intermediate filaments. Another example shows prominent ballooning degeneration. An additional example exhibits pronounced ballooning degeneration. Satellitosis, where a ballooned hepatocyte is surrounded by neutrophils, is more prevalent in alcoholic steatohepatitis than in non-alcoholic steatohepatitis. This is believed to occur due to the chemotactic effect of Mallory-Denk bodies and or the local production of chemokines. Ballooned hepatocytes exhibit a loss of cytoplasmic expression of cytochoroutine 818, with the remaining immunoreactivity confined to their Mallory-Denk bodies. This characteristic loss of CK8-18 expression is observed in ballooned hepatocytes across various conditions, including alcoholic and non-alcoholic steatohepatitis, chronic hepatitis C with concurrent steatohepatic features, and ischemia or reperfusion injury in liver allografts. It is also observed among hepatocytes with feathery degeneration in chronic cholestatic diseases. Ballooning degeneration serves as the histological hallmark of steatohepatitis. Although similar morphological changes can be observed in hepatocytes affected by acute viral hepatitis, autoimmune hepatitis, and drug-induced liver injury, I prefer to designate them as hydropic changes because the swollen hepatocytes in these conditions do not exhibit a loss of their cytoplasmic expression of CK8-18. Personally, I reserve the term ballooning degeneration exclusively for describing steatohepatitis. This is an example of a hepatocyte with hydropic change in a patient with autoimmune hepatitis. Another example shows hepatocytes with hydropic change in a patient with severe autoimmune hepatitis. Morphologically, these swollen hepatocytes could be sometimes indistinguishable from ballooned hepatocytes. Feathery degeneration is characterized by injured hepatocytes exhibiting cellular swelling and rarefaction of the cytoplasm. Several Mallory-Denk bodies are also observed. This type of degeneration arises from the detergent effect of retained bile salts, known as chronic cholestasis in cholestatic conditions. Morphologically, feathery degeneration closely resembles ballooning degeneration in light microscopy, especially feathery degenerated hepatocytes containing Mallory-Denk bodies. Furthermore, both types of degeneration fail to express cytoplasmic CK8-18. An apoptotic hepatocyte on the left exhibits a pycnotic nucleus and a shrunken angular hypereosinophilic cytoplasm. On the right is an apoptotic body, previously known as an acidophilic or Councilman body, which is a small mummified, rounded remnant of an apoptotic hepatocyte. Another apoptotic body is shown here. Apoptosis, one of the two main forms of cell death, is characterized by cytoplasmic shrinkage, chromatin condensation, and fragmentation, and the formation of cytoplasmic blebs and apoptotic bodies. Here, an apoptotic body is surrounded by a small cluster of mononuclear inflammatory cells. Apoptotic bodies are a nonspecific finding that can occur in a wide variety of acute and chronic liver diseases and may occasionally be observed in normal liver tissue. A small cluster of lymphocytes and activated Kupffer cells macrophages is observed in the lobule surrounding a dying hepatocyte. This is spotty necrosis, also referred to as focal necrosis, lytic necrosis, or oncotic necrosis, involves the death of an individual or a small number of hepatocytes. There is another example of spotty necrosis. However, the necrotic hepatocyte is often not identifiable, though the resulting parenchymal collapse, condensation of the reticulin framework, and associated mononuclear inflammatory cells can be recognized. Like apoptotic bodies, spotty necrosis is a nonspecific finding associated with a very broad range of liver diseases. Confluent necrosis refers to the necrosis of a large group of contiguous hepatocytes, typically in the perivenular region of the liver. This type of necrosis signifies a more active and severe injury to the liver parenchyma compared to spotty necrosis. Another example of confluent necrosis is shown here. It is commonly associated with conditions such as acute viral hepatitis, drug-induced liver injury, and autoimmune hepatitis. Although less common, it may also be observed in cases of chronic viral hepatitis, for example, seroconversion in chronic hepatitis B and superinfection of chronic hepatitis B by hepatitis D virus. A large area of hepatite loss with inflammatory infiltrate connects a central vein on the right with a portal tract on the left. In the classical lobular model, this is known as portal central bridging necrosis. According to the Rappaport-Assinar model, it represents extensive zone 3 confluent necrosis. Another example of bridging necrosis is demonstrated. Bridging necrosis indicates highly active and severe damage to the liver parenchyma and can occur in conditions such as acute viral hepatitis, drug-induced liver injury, and autoimmune hepatitis. This example demonstrates extensive bridging necrosis with islands or nodules of remaining hepatocytes exhibiting hydropic changes. It is not uncommonly mistaken for bridging fibrosis or cirrhosis if you are not familiar with this condition. Distinguishing between bridging necrosis and bridging fibrosis can be challenging. However, several histological features tend to favor bridging necrosis. First, the bridging region is more congested and hemorrhagic, with an abundance of ceroid-laden macrophages. Second, any ductular reaction occurs within the bridging region, rather than at the parenchymal stromal interface. Third, the trichrome stain reveals a distinct two-tone appearance, with darker staining in the residual portal tract and central vein wall, and lighter staining in areas of recent collapse. Fourth, the reticulin stain shows a condensation of residual, loosely aggregated reticulin fibers. Fifth, the orsin stain does not highlight the presence of elastic fibers. Bridging necrosis is demonstrated by a characteristic two-tone appearance on the trichrome stain, with darker staining in the wall of the central vein on the left and lighter staining in the bridging necrotic region, as well as perivenular confluent necrosis. However, it requires an adequate step of differentiation, usually by phosphomolybdic acid, during the trichrome stain. Inadequate or excessive differentiation leads to overstaining or understaining, respectively. Panacinar necrosis is featured by necrosis of the entire acinus or lobule of hepatic parenchyma. Related terms include multiacinar or multilobular necrosis, submassive necrosis, and massive necrosis. Multiacinar necrosis refers to the necrosis of multiple adjacent acini. Massive hepatic necrosis describes the necrosis of more than 70% of the entire liver, while submassive hepatic necrosis refers to necrosis affecting 30% to 70% of the liver. Panacinar necrosis, in this example, is accompanied by a ductular reaction and a moderate inflammatory infiltrate. The differential diagnosis of panacinar necrosis depends on the amount of any associated inflammatory infiltrate, which will be further discussed later in the section on the histological pattern of liver injury. Parenchymal extinction refers to the focal loss of contiguous hepatocytes due to localized ischemia caused by a vascular blockage in cirrhotic livers. This condition can affect a small portion of a liver unit, larger sections encompassing one or more adjacent units, or even an entire lobe, contingent upon the size of the obstructed vessels. It differs from panacinar necrosis by its cirrhotic background. An area of parenchymal extinction is associated with a recanalizing thrombotic portal vein in a cirrhotic liver. Typically, parenchymal extinction lesions arise from the blockage of veins larger than 100 microns. The development and buildup of parenchymal extinction can persist after cirrhosis has already manifested, potentially elucidating the gradual decline in liver functional capacity even after the initial causative injury has ceased. An interlobular bile duct is infiltrated by inflammatory cells and shows varying degrees of epithelial disarray. Another injured interlobular bile duct is infiltrated by lymphocytes and plasma cells and shows varying degrees of epithelial disarray. A florid duct lesion is a damaged interlobular bile duct surrounded by dense lymphohistiocytic infiltrate. It is a characteristic feature of primary biliary cholangitis PBC. This is another representative example of a florid duct lesion. A further beautiful example of a florid duct lesion is demonstrated here. Damage of interlobular bile ducts is mainly caused by PBC, chronic hepatitis C, drug-induced liver injury, and acute cellular rejection of the liver allograft. In this portal tract, there is only a hepatic artery without an accompanying interlobular bile duct. Such an artery is also labeled as an unpaired artery. Another unpaired hepatic artery is noted in this portal tract. If there are a significant number of portal tracts containing unpaired hepatic arteries, ductopenia should be considered. Ductopenia is traditionally described as the absence of interlobular bile ducts in over 50% of portal tracts in an adequate sample. This definition originates from early morphometric analyses on autopsies and wedge biopsies of patients with Alagille syndrome and PBC. It remains widely accepted. However, a recent study on the parallelism of hepatic arteries and bile ducts on core needle biopsies suggests an alternative definition in identifying ductopenia with a much higher sensitivity and the same specificity. This alternative definition proposes that the presence of two or more portal tracts containing unpaired hepatic arteries, comprising at least 10% of all portal tracts in a core needle liver biopsy, indicates ductopenia. The number of portal tracts, i.e., the adequacy of the biopsy sample, is not taken into account in this alternative definition. Inflammatory infiltrate is the other component of the necroinflammatory activity apart from cellular damage. To assess the inflammatory infiltrate in the liver, it's important to identify the predominant pattern based on its distribution, such as portal inflammation, interface hepatitis, or lobular inflammation, and the cellular components involve predominantly lymphocytes, plasma cells, eosinophils, mesinophils, neutrophils, or granulomas. Recognizing the main inflammatory pattern assists in refining the differential diagnosis. This portal tract is expanded by lymphocyte predominant inflammation with lymphoid follicle formation. This portal tract is also expanded by moderate to marked inflammatory infiltration of mainly small lymphocytes. This portal tract contains numerous plasma cells. This portal tract is expanded by an inflammatory infiltrate in which there are a significant number of eosinophils. This mixed portal inflammation consists of many neutrophils. An interlobular bile duct is infiltrated and distended by neutrophils, which indicates acute cholangitis. This portal tract contains moderate mixed inflammatory infiltrate, including lymphocytes, plasma cells, and scattered eosinophils. Lymphoplasmacytic cells breach the interface between the portal tract and liver parenchyma, encircling individual and small clusters of periportal hepatocytes. This feature is interface hepatitis, which was previously known as piecemeal necrosis. This is another example of prominent interface hepatitis in the presence of portal plasma cell-rich infiltrate. A higher magnification of severe interface hepatitis is shown here. Emperipolesis, characterized by the engulfment of lymphocytes by hepatocytes in the periportal region, and has been regarded as one of the typical histological features of autoimmune hepatitis. Emperipolesis is not uncommonly accompanied by interface hepatitis. Again, emperipolesis is associated with interface hepatitis. I'm interested in exploring the association between emperipolesis and autoimmune hepatitis. Emperipolesis is listed as one of the characteristic histological features in the simplified criteria for diagnosing autoimmune hepatitis. The authors of the article cited the 5th edition of Max Wien's Pathology of the Liver, which is regarded as the Bible of liver pathology, as the reference for describing all three typical histological features, including emperipolesis. However, after carefully reading through the entire chapter, I found that emperipolesis is not mentioned at all. Through the literature search, I came across the earliest paper from 1976 that discusses emperipolesis in autoimmune hepatitis, which was sometimes referred to in the past as chronic aggressive hepatitis. Additionally, a preceding paper from 1965 included a histological image showcasing emperipolesis, although the term itself wasn't explicitly used by the authors. You should probably notice that the first author of this 1965 paper was Dr. Hans Popper, a renowned Austrian-born pathologist, hepatologist, and teacher, often regarded as the founding father of hepatology. This example shows prominent lobular inflammation featured by a significant of mononuclear inflammatory cells infiltrating the sinusoids. Apoptotic bodies and faulty of Spotty necrosis are also present. In this portal tract, there is a well-formed non-caseating epithelioid granuloma. On the other hand, this portal tract contains a vaguely formed epithelioid granuloma. Granuloma could be also found within the hepatic lobule. This table outlines the primary differential diagnosis for portal and lobular granulomas, which may stem from either infectious or non-infectious origins. Important non-infectious causes to consider include PBC, sarcoidosis, and drug-induced liver injury. Here's an instance of a lipogranulome, characterized by a loose gathering of lymphocytes and macrophages encircling a central fat globule. It is present in fatty liver diseases, as well as ingesting mineral oil through food or medication. Groups of neutrophils are dispersed within the sinusoids, devoid of any associated hepatocytic damage or necrosis. This is an example of so-called surgical hepatitis, which represents a non-specific observation frequently encountered in samples obtained during surgical interventions. Neutrophils are randomly distributed but tend to aggregate around the perinular or subcapsular areas. It's important to note that surgical hepatitis lacks the characteristics of genuine hepatitis and holds no clinical relevance. It should be distinguished from other conditions featuring sinusoidal neutrophilic infiltration, such as alcoholic hepatitis, cytomegalovirus infection, and sepsis. Thank you for staying with us for another lecture in my series on essential medical liver pathology. I hope you find this lecture helpful. See you again soon.